Thank you so much. You may be seated. Thank you, and thank you for that great testimony just now. And they pretty much said it all. I've cried so much, I don't want to cry anymore right now, because I won't be able to speak if I do. I'm not a crier by nature. I'm a Marine. This has been a fabulous week for Con and I. We came to try to be a blessing, and yet tables have been turned, and we've been blessed again and again and again. And so I want to say a personal thank you to Philip and Linda Cope, and for their hospitality and kindness toward Con and I, and toward all of these that have served, and their caretakers and their spouses. And Jonathan's been my buddy this week, and I think we caught more fish than all of us put together yesterday, Jonathan. And anyhow, that's a fish story. But it's been an awesome, awesome time. I came home from Vietnam, and I'm going to give my story in a minute, but I tell people all the time I came home the sanitary way. I was hit. They came with a medevac chopper, carried me to the hospital ship, and then they took me from there to Guam Hospital, and then they carried me from there to Philadelphia Naval Hospital, so I came home the sanitary way. A lot of my buddies, a lot of my Vietnam vets didn't come home that way. And I don't want to relive that whole era, but I saw a lot of Vietnam veterans along the parade route tonight, and I felt like I was riding in the parade for all of them. And it was a era of our history that some of you are not old enough to remember, but there were no thank yous and there were no praise. A lot of them were told not to even wear their uniform, and a lot of them were spit upon and bags of urine thrown at them, called names, and all they ever did was what their country asked them to do. And it's been awesome. Thank you. Panama City and First Baptist Church, and this tremendous youth choir, what a fabulous job tonight. And all of these cadets and those that have served and in a position at all this week, just volunteers, thank you. You've just blown us away, and it's been awesome. And so I'm going to try to be brief tonight. Tell you like Elizabeth Taylor told her eighth husband, I won't keep you long. And she didn't. Everything has to be fast in America today except have an election, and that can take forever. The three little boys sitting in the front yard, they're bragging about how fast their daddies were. The first little boy said his daddy played professional baseball. He played center field. And they could hit the ball to him out against the wall in center field. He'd get the ball and run it back to home base before the runner could get around the bases. Second little boy said, that's fast, but said, my daddy is even faster than that. So my daddy played professional football. He's a quarterback. Said he can throw the ball 60 yards down the field, and he can run down there and catch it before the receiver gets there. Third little boy said, that's fast, but said, my daddy is even faster than that, said, my daddy works for the federal government. He gets off of work each day at 4:30, but by 3:30, he's already home. That's pretty fast. My special honor tonight to introduce my wife. Next week, a week from today, we will have been married for 44 years. Connie, would you stand up and let the folks meet you tonight? And And this is her birthday today. Would you all say happy birthday, Connie? Woo-hoo. Thank you so much. And it's been a great birthday for her. We have three wonderful children, Brian, Janet, and Amber. And we have six awesome grandchildren and great family. I want to read a passage of scripture tonight that I think will help a lot of people here in this room, not just those who have served and maybe having some struggles in their life and going through problems, but other people that maybe have no connection with the military at all, but it will still help you. In the book of Revelation, chapter number 12, and verse number 7, there was war in heaven. It all started with a war. It's all going to end with a war. The good thing about it, if you read Revelation chapter 19, we win. And so that's the good part. He said there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. The old dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not. Neither was there found any more place in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. So the question is, in 2016, how do we overcome this accuser? The very next verse tells us two ways they overcame. Number one, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And I'm going to give my testimony tonight. And all testimonies, when I was talking about my testimony tonight, I want you to think about your story. Everybody has a story. Three friends died. They were taken for orientation about what would happen at their funeral. They were asked the question when people come by and they look in your casket, what do you want people to say? First guy was a doctor, a medical doctor, and he said, well, I studied the best universities and I was at the top of my class and I cared greatly about the people that I took care of. And they asked the next guy, what do you want people to say when they come by and they look in your casket? He was an educator, a teacher, and a similar thing as a doctor. He said, I too studied the best, and I care greatly about the students that I taught. So then they asked the third guy, when people come by and they look in your casket, what do you want people to say? He said, I want them to say, look, he's moving. Well, what do you want people to say when you come to the end of your life? When you go out to the cemetery and there's a marker, there's enough words on that marker. We gather some information about the person that is buried there, their name, of course, and then maybe a Bible verse or something about their family, maybe their military career. But then there's always the dates. There's the date that the person was born and then the date that the person died. Ladies and gentlemen, young people, there's even something more important than the dates. In between the dates is the little dash. And it's what's on your dash that matters the most. What's your story? Every story has a beginning. Mine has a great beginning. I wish everyone could have been raised in the kind of home that I was raised in. It wasn't a perfect home by any stretch of the imagination. It was a great home. My father was a Southern Baptist pastor for almost 60 years. He lacked a few months being six full decades of pastoring and preaching God's word. My mother, I talked to her last night. She's 91. In June will be 92. Up until a year ago, she mowed her yard with a push mower. I'm not talking about one of them you push down the handle and it takes off. I'm talking about a push mower. And she called me some time ago, and she said, Tim, I sold my car. I said, Mom, why'd you sell your car? She said, well, I'm 91. I've never had an accident, and I've never had a ticket, and I want to go out on top. I couldn't say that when I was 17 years old. But there were five of us kids. We were raised in a godly home. We went to church Sunday morning. We went back Sunday night. We went back Wednesday night. I told a group of teenagers the other day, I was on drugs. Whenever I was 9 years old, Mom and Dad drug us to church, and they drug us home from church. We were raised in a godly home. We were taught in our home that the Bible was the Word of God. We were taught that there was only one true living God. That was the God of this Bible. We were taught that Jesus Christ was the Son of God, that He was the only way to have a relationship with this true God was through His Son, Jesus Christ. We were raised in a good home, in a godly home. I cannot imagine being raised in an atheist home. Atheism is on the rise in America. Now, I'm on Twitter, and if I get real bored, I go on and mention the word atheist, and they come out of the woodwork, man. It's exciting. I tweeted last night that if it wasn't for God, there would be no atheist. Think about that one. I remember when the Russian cosmonauts went into outer space for the very first time, and the whole world was watching, and they came back to the Earth, and the media was there, and one of those Russian cosmonauts said, "We've been to outer space, and we did not see God, and since we did not see God, that must mean there is no God." And the next Sunday at the great First Baptist Church of Dallas, Texas, the pastor, Dr. W.A. Criswell, exclaimed to his people, and he said, "Ah, if only they would have stepped out of their spacesuits, then they would have seen God." Professing themselves to be wise, they became as fools. But it makes a difference how we raise our children. It makes a difference what kind of a home that we're raised in. I was raised in a great home. The most important thing that ever happened in my life happened when I was a 10-year-old boy. My dad was preaching on Sunday morning, and that morning, for the first time in my life, I got under conviction. I don't know where you understand what conviction is, but it's when God comes and He begins to talk to you about things. I'm talking about individually and dealing with you about important things like death and life and heaven and hell and eternity. And if you're in church and conviction comes to you and the preacher's preaching, you would just like for the preacher just to shut up. No more preaching, no more singing. Please just get me out of the building. Well, that morning, that's what happened to me. And when the invitation started, I was miserable. All I could see was hell. And somebody said, "You shouldn't get saved just to stay out of hell." Well, maybe not, but that's not a bad reason to get saved. And that morning, I went forward as a 10-year-old boy. My mom came and knelt beside me. And that morning, I repented of my sins, received Christ as my Savior, and I got born into the family of God. There's a lot of great things about salvation, but I believe perhaps the best is the fact that it's eternal. You see, when God does something, He does it right. God doesn't save you and then put you out on a tree limb somewhere and tell you to make it if you can. He gives you eternal, everlasting life. I was excited about being a Christian, told my family, my friends, and what had happened in my life. However, when I became a teenager, something else happened in my life. Never happened overnight, but rather gradually, I began to put things before God. Football, and basketball, and baseball, and track and field, these things soon became my gods. And my dad told me, "Tim, there's nothing wrong with you playing ball unless you put it before God. And then it's wrong." And I didn't want to listen to that. And little by little, I began to put these things before God in my life. And when I did, I began to have problems. I began to rebel. I rebelled at school. I rebelled against God. I rebelled against my mom and dad. You say, "Well, Tim, what did your parents do when you rebel?" Well, they had never read any of Dr. Spock's books on child psychology. Dr. Spock believed that if a child was frustrated, whatever it took to get the frustration out, let him do it. If he wanted to pick up a rock and throw it through the window, if that would help him get his frustration out, let him throw the rock through the window. Well, my dad had other ways of getting that frustration out. We lived on a farm for a while, and behind the farmhouse was a willow tree. Now, I don't know whether you know what willow trees are good for or not. You don't get any fruit off of them. They're not even a good shade tree. The only thing they're good for is to get a switch off of. The only praying I did back then was for that tree to die. It never did die. I'd have to go out and get my own switch. I'd be hurting before I got back because I knew what was about to happen. And Mom and Dad, they would always talk to us kids before they spanked us, and they'd say something like this: "Tim, this is going to hurt me a whole lot worse than it's going to hurt you." I thought, "Isn't that dumb? If you'll give me that switch, I'll show you it's going to hurt the worst." And I said oftentimes, even before I joined the Marines, that I served under the stars and the stripes. My dad furnished the stripes. I saw the stars. They believed in old-fashioned discipline, but many, many times I would slip out behind their back to do what I wanted to do. I attended a public school. Most of my friends were not Christians. Most of their parents were not saved. I made up my mind as a teenager I could live my own life.
My junior year in high school, I set 2 track records, won the long jump, won the hurdles, winning ribbons and trophies, but all the time getting further and further away from God. He said, well, Tim, what did God do? What God declares in Revelation chapter 3, verse 19, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. I saw 5 of my high school friends killed in car wrecks. Every time I would see one of them in a casket, I knew that it very easily could have been me. God would speak to my heart, but I wouldn't listen. I kept running. I graduated from high school. I started college the day, working nights. In the meantime, my life became one disaster after another, and I didn't think it could get any worse. But it wasn't long till I got fired from my job, and then I got kicked out of college. Nowhere to go, nothing to do, and again, my life full of confusion. Walking down the street in my hometown, McLeansboro, Illinois. I went by the post office and I noticed a sign. I'd seen this sign before, but it never got my attention like it did that day. It was a picture of a young man in a sharp-looking uniform, and up the top of that sign it said the Marines are looking for a few good men. I didn't know who the rest of them were, but I went in and told that recruiter that I had found at least one of what they would have been looking for. Now, to be real frank with you young people, I was tired of living at home. I wanted to change. I wanted something different. I was tired of being told what time to go to bed and what time to get out of bed and how to get my hair cut and what I could do and what I could not do, so I joined the United States Marine Corps. It wasn't the most intelligent thing I ever did. They put me on a Greyhound bus, sent me to Parris Island, South Carolina. I got off that bus and stepped out of those yellow footprints, and I met the guy they called drill instructor. I was there less than 24 hours when I decided I didn't like him and he didn't like me. But you know the real reason why I didn't like him? He was in authority. I didn't like authority. I was rebellious toward all authority, but I was soon to discover that no matter where I would ever go in this life, there would always be authority, with God being the supreme in all authority. I laid awake nights, many nights, platoon 305, thinking about my life, the shame and the disgrace that I brought to my dad's ministry, to my own family. My attitude began to change in boot camp. The Marines had some things to help it change. I graduated from boot camp with a meritorious promotion to ITR, then to engineering school at Camp Lejeune, graduated with another meritorious promotion, and then I received my orders that I was to go to Vietnam. I had 3 weeks leave. I went home to Illinois and spent those 3 weeks with Mom and Dad. On Sunday, before I was to leave on Monday, I went to church with my parents. And in the service that day, I thought that I had made things right with God. On Monday, Mom and Dad drove me to St. Louis. I got on that big plane, that jet no more, left the runway. I told God that I couldn't do it. Those men were Marines. I was afraid they'd laugh at me. I was afraid they'd make fun of me. Went to Vietnam, was there for 9 months. And I didn't go back to doing a lot of the things I'd done before, but friend, listen, if you're not for God, you're against him. There is no middle ground. You're either helping the cause of Christ or you're hurting the cause of Christ. I had opportunity after opportunity to live for God. My mother sent me a Bible. And on the inside of that Bible, she wrote these words, Tim, this Bible can keep you from sin, or sin can keep you from this Bible. I put it in the bottom of my footlocker. I had no prayer life. I had no testimony. There was a black Marine in my squad by the name of Lee Gore. Corporal Lee Gore and I flew to Vietnam on the same plane. We were the best of friends. He was a Christian living for God. I was saved, but I was running from God. Oftentimes, I'd seen him sit down to Edra's rack and read his Bible. I'd seen him openly witness and talk to other Marines about the Lord. I knew this was the story. This was the testimony that I was supposed to have. But I wouldn't do it. 30 days left in Nam, a top sergeant offered me a desk job. Simply meant that I didn't have to go back out to the field, to the bush anymore. And that was where the primary danger was. But for some reason, I told him I'd rather spend the rest of my time with my own men. I was told to take them on a minesweep. I'd been on numerous minesweeps. The only thing particularly different about this one Most of my men at that time were new in Vietnam. The only training that most of them had on a minesweep was what they got back in the States. It was a lot different than walking an actual minesweep. I got my men together early that morning, March the 8th, 1971. I told my men that day that I would walk point. Point man was the first man to squad. There'd be 15, 20 meters at another Marine, 15, 20 meters at another Marine, and we'd be staggered out in that kind of formation. Normally, I would have been in the back of the squad with the radom and the corpsman and the lieutenant. I wasn't trying to be a hero or anything like that, simply trying to show my men how to walk point. Our job was to locate landmines. Rounds had not yet been detonated, and to clear the area of those devices. We walked that morning without any trouble. We found a couple of rounds, we detonated them. We stopped at noon hour to eat. And while I was eating, my friend, Lee Gore, asked me if I wanted him to take over his point. Gore could have very easily have done it. He was as well trained, as well equipped as I. But for some reason, I told him I would finish out the day. And then on tomorrow, he could show the new men how to do it. We picked up where we left off from. 45 minutes later, I stepped on a 60-pound mine. It blew me several feet in the air. It ripped both of my legs off of my body. I should have been killed instantly. It was a big enough mine to destroy a Jeep. In the midst of the confusion, in the midst of all my pain, I looked up. My head was laying in the lap of Corporal Lee Gore. Lee wasn't cussing the president or the communists or the Vietnamese or no one else, but with tears streaming down his face, openly, out loud, praying, asking God to help me. And I can remember it this evening as though it happened just a few short moments ago. Quang Nam province, a little after 1:30 in the afternoon, I looked up that day and I made God a promise. It was something like these simple words: God, if you'll let me live and get back home to mom and dad, I'll do with my life what you want me to do. Well, I've made God so many promises on so many other occasions, but I never meant it like I meant it that day. They came with a medevac chopper, carried me to the hospital ship, the USS Sanctuary. The second day I was on that ship, two naval doctors gave up hope. Infection had set in, running a high degree temperature, a lot of complications. They never expected me to survive. I lay on the hospital ship for 2 weeks, unconscious most of the time. Folks, could we wait for just a few moments for everyone to move? It's a very disturbing thing right now. We'll be able to get everything together once I'm finished here in just a few moments. Just give me that respect for just a moment. I lay on the hospital ship for 2 weeks, unconscious most of the time. They took me to the island of Guam, the naval hospital, where I spent the next 2 weeks, unconscious most of that time. I weighed 187 pounds before I was hit. The island of Guam, I weighed a little less than 80 pounds. During that first four-week period, Mom and Dad received visits from the Marines, the Red Cross, numerous telegrams. And from all that they had been told, they never expected it to see their oldest son alive again. But God had a plan for my life. Several years ago in Dayton, Ohio, Earl Lewis came to the crusade where I was speaking. Earl was the fifth man back on the minesweep that day. He told Connie and I that it looked like someone had taken a 5-gallon bucket of red paint and just poured it all over me. He said not a one of my men expected me to live. In that crusade, Earl gave his heart to Jesus Christ and now is a faithful member of that church. Several years ago, matter of fact, I go to Paris Island 4 times a year to speak to the recruits on Sunday morning at Protestant Chapel. We have 1.5 to 2 hours. I speak from anywhere to 2,500 Marine recruits to our largest crowd a year ago in August, 4,500. We've seen over 16,000 recruits get out of their seats and come and give their hearts to Jesus Christ in the last 3 years. Been the most amazing thing. I took Earl Lewis with me a year ago in August. I took Lee Gore with me at the same time. It was the first time they'd seen each other since Vietnam. Very emotional reunion for them and for myself, of course. They brought me back to the States to the Philadelphia Naval Hospital where I spent the next 8 months. 13 major operations. When the doctors were through and all the surgery was over, I had 3 inches remaining on my right leg, 11 inches on my left leg, but no other part of my body was hurt. Now, some would tell us tonight there was nothing more than an accident, but I remind you that with God, There are no accidents. God was not asleep on March the 8th, 1971. You see, as a 10-year-old boy, I said yes to Christ. However, as a teenager, I decided that I could live my own life. I made a choice, a deliberate choice to run. And I ran and ran and ran to March the 8th, 1971, when the running was over. I went home from the hospital. I went to my dad's church. I went forward publicly and made things right. It was in that church that I met Connie. We fell in love with each other and were soon married. It wasn't long after we were married that God called me to preach. Friends and even relatives tried to discourage me. They said, be so hard, so difficult. But I said, if that's what God wants me to do, then that's what I'll do. I pastored for 5 years in Southern Illinois, and now I'm a 38th year as an evangelist. I've had the privilege to speak in every state, with exception of North Dakota, and I'm not sure anybody lives up there anymore, and many, many foreign countries preaching God's word. And I'm going to tell you tonight, as I've said on so many occasions, the past 45 plus years of my life have absolutely been the happiest years of my life. He said, but Tim, you're in a wheelchair. Your legs are gone. Tonight I'm in a wheelchair. But tonight I'm in the will of God. And that, my friend, makes all the difference in the world. Here's how the book of Job says it in chapter 5 and verse 17. Happy is the man whom God correcteth. Tim, are you telling us that God would do something like that to a person? No, God doesn't necessarily do things to us. He does things for us because he loves us, because he cares for us, and because we are his children. You're saved tonight, but you're out of the will of God. This would be a perfect event to get your life right with God. It took a landmine explosion, two legs in a wheelchair for me to finally say, all right, God, whatever you want. And there may be some tonight. Your life has never, ever been changed by the power of God. Can I tell you up front, although we're in a Baptist church, and I'm a Baptist, that being a Baptist won't take anybody to heaven. Not about being a Baptist or Methodist, Lutheran or Church of Christ, Assembly of God or Catholic or Mormon, anything else. It's about a personal relationship with Christ. Here it is, friend. Over 2,000 years ago, God sent his only son to this earth. God didn't have 20 sons. God didn't have two sons. God had one begotten son, Jesus Christ. I've got one son. I've got two daughters. I'm not willing to give their lives for any of your lives. Now, if the opportunity presented at the exact moment, maybe I would give my life for your life, but I'm not giving my kids' lives for your life. God gave his only son for you and for me. He hung on an old rugged cross, and he suffered, and he bled, and he died for me and for you and for the sins of the world. And then they took him and they put him in a borrowed tomb. Here's what separates Christianity from every other single religion on the face of the earth. You go to the place where they put the body of Jesus, he's not there. On the third day, he got up from the grave, victorious over sin, over death, and over hell. And tonight, he's alive. And here's the great news. He wants to come and live in your life. Tim, how in the world does this happen? How does God's son come and live in my life? You come to this place. Now, I'm not talking about this geographical building. I'm talking about this moment right now in your life to understand that inside of God that you're a sinner. All of us are. Every one of us have sinned and come short of God's glory. And it's our sins that separates us from God. And there's only one way to be reconciled to God. And that's through his son. When you by faith say yes to Jesus, what he did for you on that cross, and what he did for you when he got up from that grave. I want you to bow your heads for just a moment this evening. I'm going to ask that no one disturb anyone. No one talk to anyone. I'm not going to embarrass anyone. I'm not going to intimidate anyone. I don't do that. I'm going to give you an opportunity tonight, right where you're at, to say yes to Christ. I'm not going to ask you to come forward tonight. I do that. I do it at Paris Island in Protestant Chapel. I've done it on many military bases across America and throughout the world. But tonight, I will give you an opportunity to say yes to Christ. If your life has never been changed by the power of God, you see, friend, there's something that only God can do. Linda and Philip can't do this for you. Tim Lee can't do this for you. No one else can. Only God. Tonight, if you understand that you're a sinner and that your sins can separate you from God forever, but you want to have a relationship with this one true and living God, then tonight, if you would by faith say yes to Jesus. You say, Tim, that sounds too simple. Tell God that. He's the one that made it that way. He said, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So I'm going to pray what we oftentimes refer to as a sinner's prayer. And if you would like to be saved tonight, right where you're sitting or right where you're standing, and you're as serious as you know how to be, no playing church, no playing games with God, would you pray this prayer in your heart and mean it with your whole heart right now? Dear God, I know I'm a sinner. And I know my sins can separate me from you forever. But tonight, I want to be saved. Please forgive me of all my sin. Wash me as white as snow. Make me your child. Right now. This very moment, I am trusting Jesus Christ and Him alone as my Lord and my Savior. Take me to heaven when I die, for I am now your child. Our heads are still bowed for just another moment. No one's looking but me and God. I'm not going to embarrass anyone at all. Again, I don't do that. But if you just now prayed that prayer in your heart when I prayed it out loud, you say, Tim, I prayed that prayer when you prayed it, and I meant it with my whole heart, and I'm not the least bit ashamed of it. Let me see your hand right now. Just hold them up high. Just hold them up high. There's one, there's two, there's three, there's four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53. You can take them down. Those of you that already knew Jesus before tonight, if you're rejoicing that in this last moment, 53 of these people said yes to Christ, would you give them a big hand and tell them that you're happy for them tonight? Woo! Look right up here for a moment. Yes, that's the most important decision you'll ever make in your life. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to write today's date down. It's my wife's birthday. And so on April the 21st at exactly 6:30 p.m., you said yes to Jesus Christ. At the very moment that you by faith said yes to Jesus, you became God's child forever. I don't expect you to understand everything as a 10-year-old child. I certainly didn't understand everything. But you understand that God has a plan. And when you go to the end of the road, and there's the dates, and there's the dash, this is the most important thing that you'll ever have on your dash. April 21st, 2016, at Warrior Beach Retreat, you said yes to Jesus Christ. Don't be ashamed of it. Don't be embarrassed. Tell other people about it. Those of you that are part of our group, and tomorrow when you have your testimony time, don't be ashamed to let people know that tonight you said yes to Jesus Christ. Thank you for letting me be here. Remember this. In America, there's some things worth living for. There's some things worth fighting for. And if needs be, there's some things worth dying for. Thank you so much. God bless you.